Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Sapna Dadwal. I'm working as a professor in the Department of Management at St. Andrew's Institute of Technology and Management. This is my lecture 22 of Business Law of Unit 4. I'm discussing in this liabilities of parties to negotiable instrument, then crossing of check, types of check, privileges of holder in due course, and the difference between promissory note and check, then check and bill of exchange. So these are all topics I am going to discuss in this lecture. I have already told you these are the topics I am going to discuss in this lecture, lecture number 22. I'm starting with first, then liability of maker, drawer and acceptor as principal, that of other parties as surety. So the maker of promissory note or check, the drawer of bill of exchange, until the acceptance, and the acceptor are in the absence of contract to the contrary, respectively, are liable thereon as principal debtors, and the other parties thereto are liable thereon as surety for the maker, drawer or acceptor, as the case may be. It's very clear from this that maker, drawer, acceptor and principal, they are liable for the holder in due course. Then next is liability of prior party as principal debtor in respect of each subsequent party. I have already discussed this in the last lecture also, that all subsequent parties or all prior parties, they are liable for a holder in due course. As I am starting with, as between the parties, so liable as securities, each prior party is in the absence of contract to the contrary, also liable thereon as a principal debtor in respect of each subsequent parties. So the prior parties are liable with the principal debtor for the subsequent parties. Now, the next topic is nature of suretyship. So, as per the suretyship or the nature of suretyship, is described in section 39 of Negotiable Instrument Act. So when the holder of an accepted bill of exchange enters into any contract with the acceptor, which under section 134 or 135 of the Indian Contract Act 1872 would discharge other parties, so the holder may expressly reserve his right to charge the other parties in such a case they are not discharged. Now, discharge of endorsed liability. So, it is nature of surety, it is very clear that all are liable. The surety is liable, he doesn't get discharged. Now, the next is discharge of endorser's liability. Where the holder of negotiable instrument without the consent of the endorser destroys or impairs the endorser's remedy against a prior party, the endorser is discharged from liability to the holder to same extent as if the instrument has been paid at maturity. So, endorsers cannot destroy remedy against the prior party. If he does that, then he is discharged from the liability to the holder to same extent as if the instrument has been paid at maturity. Now the next is effect of forced endorsement on acceptor's liability. An acceptor of bill of exchange already endorsed is not relieved from liability by reason that such endorsement is forced. It's very clear that even if the endorsement is forced, the acceptor of a bill doesn't discharge from his duties or discharge from his liabilities. Then next one is liability of acceptor of a bill drawn in fictitious name. An acceptor of bill of exchange drawn in fictitious name and payable to the drawer's order is not relieved from liability to any holder in due course. So in the ground being that such name is fictitious. Very clear from this, even if the bill of exchange was drawn on the fictitious name, the drawer is not relieved from that towards the liability towards the holder in due course. He cannot say that this was drawn on fictitious name. He is liable to pay. Then liability on negotiable instrument made without consideration. A negotiable instrument without consideration drawn, made, accepted, endorsed or transferred for a consideration creates no obligation of payment between the parties to the transaction. But if any such party has transferred the instrument with or without endorsement to holder for consideration, so such holder and every subsequent holder deriving title from this instrument or from him transferring may recover the amount due on such instrument from the transferor. Now the difference between check and promissory note. So starting with check, check is always drawn on the bank. So whereas in case of promissory note, it is usually drawn on some person or on the name of the firm. Then check is always payable on demand, whereas promissory note may be payable on demand or expiry of the fixed period of time. Then check doesn't require a stamp, whereas promissory note must be properly stamped. In case of check drawn payable to bearer on demand shall be valid, whereas bill payable on demand can never be drawn. Then check can be crossed, then whereas promissory note cannot be crossed. Whereas check, the payment of check may be countermanded by the drawer, whereas in case of promissory note the payment of a bill cannot be countermanded. And in case of check it doesn't require acceptance, whereas in case of promissory note it must be accepted by the drawee. Now the next topic is difference between check and bill of exchange. Check is always drawn on bank, whereas bill of exchange, as in the case of promissory note too, it is also usually drawn on the name of some person or on the name of some firm. Whereas check is always payable on demand, whereas bill of exchange may be payable on demand or on the expiry of fixed period. Check doesn't require any acceptance, whereas bill of exchange require acceptance from the drawee. Check doesn't require stamp, whereas bill of exchange must be properly stamped. Without stamp it will not be properly valid. It will not be called as negotiable instrument. Whereas in case of check, it is payable immediately on the demand without any days of grace. In case of bill of exchange or time bill of exchange, 3 days of grace is allowed from due date within which the payment can be made. check drawn payable to bearer on demand shall be valid. In case of bill of exchange, a bill payable on demand can never be drawn payable to the bearer. Then check can be crossed, whereas bill of exchange never, it cannot be crossed. And in case of check, notice of dishonor is not required, but in case of bill of exchange, notice of dishonor is usually required. So now next topic is types of check and crossing of check. So ordinarily the bank makes payment on the check drawn upon it at its public counter itself. This mode of payment entails some risk also. A wrong person may take possession of a check and obtain the payment at bank counter. A solution to this problem is crossing of the check. So in this context, the checks can be divided into two types. Our checks are of two types. First is open check, the second one is crossed check. I'm starting with first, that is open check. An open check or uncrossed check is payable at the counter of the drawee bank on the presentation of the check. Such a check runs great risk in the course of circulation, because once a wrong person takes away the payment of a check, of open check, it is difficult to trace him. It is also known as uncrossed check. Now the second comes, crossed check. A crossed check is payable only through a collective banker and not directly at the counter of the bank. Thus, crossing affords or gives security and protection to the holder of the check. Because when payment of check has been drawn through a banker, it may easily be detected to whose use the money has been received. The collecting banker credits the proceeds to the account of the payee of the check. Now, typing of crossing. There are three types of crossing: general crossing, special crossing, and restrictive crossing. I'm starting with first, general crossing. So where check bears across its face, usually on the left hand top corner, two parallel transverse lines without any words or with words and company or with like not negotiable written in between these two parallel lines, it is called a general crossing. So these are the specimens I have given you of general crossing. The first one is there is nothing written, second one and company is written. So these are the specimen of general crossing. Now I am starting with second, special crossing. Where check bears across its face an addition of the name of a banker with or without the words not negotiable, called as special crossing or special cross check. These are the specimen of the special crossing. Now the third one, restrictive crossing. So besides the above two types of crossing, in recent years the practice of crossing check with the words account payee or account payee only has sprung up. Such crossing is called as restrictive crossing. So I have given you two specimens of restrictive crossing. Now the next topic is privileges of holder in due course. The holder in due course gets the instrument free from all defects. Now the second one is the right of holder due course to recover money is not at all affected, even though the instrument was originally inchoate. Stamped instrument, inchoate means illegal or wrong stamped instrument. Then third one is, third privilege is, all prior parties are liable to the instrument. So all prior parties to the instrument, maker, whether it is maker, drawer, receptor or any endorser, continue to remain liable to the holder in due course until the instrument is duly satisfied. The next privilege is the holder in due course can enforce payment of fictitious bills also. He gets the good title in fictitious bills also. The next is the holder in due course, if gets the investment instrument with conditional delivery, it will not have any effect on the holder in due course. So now these are the privileges which the holder in due course enjoys while getting the instrument. Now these are the questions which are related to the above topics I have discussed in this lecture. If any query is there, please you can contact me, and if there is any writing mistake, please ignore that writing mistake. Thank you so much.